Ooh, ooh, ooh. There's only one of you, so tell us your story like only you do. We're on the same team of dreamers, a happy, scrappy group of believers. So come, play a part. There's room for mistakes and messes and art. Who cares if there's not many takers? We're doing it for the makers.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to the For the Makers podcast. We are so excited you are here today. Rach, what's up, dude? How are you?
Oh, hey. I'm great. I'm excited about this one.
I'm excited too. I'm so pumped. It's going to be a great episode today, you guys. We have somebody super, super special here on our podcast, a dear friend and a just incredible performer. And we're really excited for you guys to hear from her, get her wisdom. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Totally.
Rachel, will you intro our guest for us?
Yeah, 100%. Today on the podcast, we have none other than Natalie Weiss.
Woo, woo, woo.
Natalie Weiss gained an international following from her performance videos and popular YouTube web series, Breaking Down The Riffs. I have definitely watched so many. As a private vocal coach and masterclass teacher, she trains performers across the U.S. and throughout the world. Natalie guides singers with her trademarked method to break down riffs and runs from pop icons and often refers to her mission as pop singing for dummies. I love that. Natalie is one of the most sought after voices among new musical theater writers and is a soloist on several albums by numerous new musical theater composers. She recently completed a run as the Witch in Paramount Theatre's production of Into the Woods. She is part of the vocal ensemble on the acclaimed soundtrack for The Greatest Showman, can be heard on the original Broadway cast recording of Dear Evan Hansen as one of the virtual community voices, and is one of four singers on the main jingles for The Incredibles 2. I didn't know that until I read your bio, and I was like, oh yeah.
That's my people that find that out, that's their most, they're most excited about that.
I was amazing. Like,
we can play it.
Yeah. Okay, oh my gosh.
Yeah. Hold on. I'll finish your bio and then we got to talk about that. Other credits include Everyday Rapture on Broadway, understudy Menonettes, Emojiland off-Broadway, construction worker, tours of Les Miserables, Swing, and Wicked, ensemble and understudy Elphaba, and regional productions of Ghost and Chess. She was also, casually, a semi-finalist on American Idol season 4. Natalie received her BFA in musical theater from Penn State University. Natalie, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you. Hey. Were you born during season 4 of American Idol? Carrie Underwood, how old were you when she won?
Oh, shoot.
Oh,
I don't remember.
2005. What year was that?
I was 10.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Elementary
Not
school.
Not that young.
Oh, yeah.
No. No.
We're
pushing 30.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know. Yeah. It's crazy.
Okay, wait. Hold on. We got to go back to this Incredibles 2 thing.
Yeah, we're definitely going to have to play.
Because I run to the Incredibles soundtrack.
Really?
Yeah, because it gets me so amped.
Oh my God, are we going to play
it? And those harmonies are
That's just
legit.
Two of us.
Okay, wait.
Okay, I'll tell you. So basically I got an email name drop from Alex Lackamore.
Cool.
Famous. And then it was just four of us. And it was just like, do you want to come in and do this? And I was like, yes.
Yeah, yes, the answer is yes.
And then, I'm on the alto harmony. So like Caramelacus is scrawling and I'm just like in the middle. But you can hear it.
Okay, wait.
So we'll play...
The Incredibles. There's
three. Frozone, Elastigirl,
yeah.
And The Incredibles. It's so funny because my other friend like flipped out about everything. Just
no
The Incredibles
way.
2.
Oh my gosh, that's amazing.
Here comes Elastigirl.
Yeah, that's one of them. It's like a minute.
Okay.
Yeah. Here comes Elastigirl. Oh, I can hear you for sure.
That's basically it.
Okay, kid you not, I run to this song.
What?
I run to this song.
And then
song.
I think you can, Frozone. I think you can hear me in Frozone.
Wait, this is so
cool. This is blowing
your mind. That's so cool, Natalie.
I don't see Frozone.
Incredible.
Pow, pow, pow.
Yeah.
Pow, pow, pow.
Yeah.
Harmonies. Pow, pow, pow.
Pow, pow, pow. Wait, do I know it?
Pow, pow, pow.
Yeah.
Wait. Pow, pow, pow.
This one's so good.
Is this the open, like the Mr. Incredible or?
Yeah. Where is it? Here we go.
Pow, pow, pow.
Yeah. Pow, pow, pow. Mr. Incredible.
the bad guys.
I remember him being
insane.
Like,
saying
vibrato,
vibrato. Oh my gosh, that's amazing.
Pow, 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 pow. Yeah, those harmonies are tight.
Tight, dude.
That is crazy. Okay, yeah.
You're like, pow, pow, pow. That's so funny. You're yeah. pow, pow, pow.
Pow, pow, pow.
That's good.
You know,
I love it.
It just kills me because everybody's so excited about you being on this soundtrack, but I'm like, Natalie also performed at the Oscars.
Yeah, and nobody's
like,
Greatest Showman.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And yet people are like,
pow, pow, pow.
Pow, pow, pow. Pow. I'm just like niche in that way.
Yeah, exactly.
I love that you know pow, pow, pow.
Oh, yeah. How can you not?
And then there's like seven. There's like pow, 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 pow. Then there's like more at the end.
Yeah.
I mean, that's like it's a crazy song. Mm-hmm. And this is not, I remember hearing the soundtrack for the first time and I was like, this is complicated music.
Yeah.
Okay, Natalie, let's just start at the beginning because I feel like that will open up a lot of conversation. Mm-hmm. So we ask the same five questions to all of our guests. And the first one is, what got you into the arts?
Okay, I would say that my parents put me into classical piano lessons at like four.
Cool, yeah.
So they like, I guess, saw, maybe I was singing along to like Billy Joel, like time, like little things.
Yeah.
Maybe she's musical. So like little music classes. And then they took me, cause you know, I'm like not part of, nobody understands what I do.
Yeah,
totally.
They're
like, your life is weird, but they do love pop concerts. So like I went to Madonna at age five, which was just cone boobs inappropriate.
Wow. Yeah. At five.
At literally five. Yeah, I remember it was the Blonde Ambition tour. Just so inappropriate.
Oh my gosh.
And then Billy Joel at seven, Janet Jackson. I was like so excited to touch the backup dancers' hands. At like, I was very young with memories like that.
Yeah.
And then like when I was playing piano, Mariah Carey and Whitney Houston, like the Bodyguard soundtrack for me, like was very memorable. Not to get sad, but my mom had breast cancer when I was eight. She's totally fine.
Yeah.
But I was like sent away to family's homes, like very good friends while she was getting treatment. And I like distinctly remember just like crying myself to sleep for I Have Nothing. Just
wow.
Like, and then basically while doing that, singing
right
pretty badly along with the soundtrack.
Sure.
Just yelling.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Of course.
As we know.
Yeah.
And then just like putting on little shows, like for the family, again, yelling incorrectly.
Sure.
And then doing like Peter Pan at day camp and like getting the lead when like the older campers were like, this 10-year-old got the lead. And I'm telling you, I was like, I had nodules twice. I think I've maybe told.
Yeah.
But I had literal like nodes. I was so hoarse. I was like, Tinkerbell, tink. Like screaming, like I'm flying. Was like, I'm flying. Like
oh
yelling.
My gosh.
Wow.
Yeah.
No vibrato.
Yeah.
You know, just screaming.
Yeah.
And like, yeah, terrible acting, just, you know, as we do.
Yeah.
So then I like do the talent show in like fourth grade as a piano player. And as an 11-year-old, I remember in fifth grade, I was like, I'll do the greatest love of all. Like no presence, like swaying, but like I had vibrato and could riff like out of nowhere, probably listening to the two icons.
Yeah.
And then, is that the origin or do I keep going through high school?
I mean, keep going. Cause I'm kind of curious. Like,
that's the beginning. And then, when I went to a performing arts high school for acting, we took some voice lessons, dance classes, learned a little bit about singing, but not really until college.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
That's the origin.
Wow. So classical piano was like the first in.
The first thing. Yeah.
How, because I remember like when I first met you just being like, wait, what? Realizing how well you play piano.
Hey.
How much has that, like, are you really thankful that you had that?
So background? Thankful.
How long did you take lessons?
So, yeah, I took from like 4 to 15 and I was like the only white girl in the studio. All lovely Asian students that were just adorable. My teacher was from, I forget where she's from, but her name was Stella Shu. Stella was an icon. So I definitely learned early on, but I had no music theory and was really lacking. Mm-hmm. So then when I was 15, my mom found a play by ear pop coach. Mm-hmm. So I would learn about like major, minor, diminished, augmented and theory, which I never had that.
Yeah.
Wow, so then he would teach me how to like, I remember, I'm sure you know, Backstreet Boys.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do you know the song The Perfect Fan?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Mom, you always were the perfect fan.
Yes.
So that song, I had to learn how to like find the bass note and like transcribe the chords because I didn't learn that. So I was a lot of that in like sophomore year of high school.
Yeah.
Okay. Lauryn Hill, That Thing, first song I ever learned how to play, like learning about chords.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then I sort of combined it. And then in high school, when my friends and I would just like sing through the Aida soundtrack.
Sure, sure, sure.
You know, a step too far, as you do. We would just harmonize and I would play. And then I'm so grateful because then in college, you know, my freshman year, when you meet people in the first week, they're like, let's play Jason Robert Brown. So like, you know, playing, learning and sight reading Jason Robert Brown in a practice room makes you a better piano player.
100%.
So then I was like kind of practicing and then harmonizing. And then people like in high school, I always say like my coaching career started in high school probably.
Wow, yeah.
Because people would like come off stage and they would be like, we had this joke, PPRPNP, perfect pitch, relative pitch, no pitch or something.
Oh my
gosh.
My
friend would be like, was that pitchy? And I'm like, do you want me to tell you that or no? So they would trust my opinion and then I would obviously not get paid. I'm not working.
Right.
And then in college, same thing. Like we had this, you know how in curriculums nowadays, there's like a pop element.
Yeah.
There
yeah.
was not that.
Right.
So like 1 week in auditions class in 2006, mm-hmm. The theme was Britney and Christina Day, because that's what they're like, Britney and Christina Day.
Yeah, right, right, right.
Of course.
And everyone was like, ugh, Natalie, you suck. You're going to be good at this. Ugh, it's not fair. And I was like, I don't know what I'm doing. I just sing pop.
Yeah.
So then I was like the go-to help me with this pop song, even though like, I don't know what I'm, I just sing pop.
Right.
Then as it like developed in terms of like, oh, I've been like collecting these riffs my whole life. Let me figure out how to teach them. And then that's sort of like how it started, mm-hmm. Like building a made up thing.
Right.
What was your first question? The piano.
Oh,
grateful.
Yeah.
So now, you know, if I have an audition nowadays because of tapes, they have plunk tracks, but
right.
I mean, you would be,
yeah.
you'd have to hire somebody last minute. So mm-hmm. now I can plunk always. And a lot of voice teachers don't play.
Right.
You know, and I'm like grateful that I can mm-hmm. play. And I usually am good enough to know, like, I know if I can't play it, it's not necessarily that it's hard for an accompanist to bring in, but I also know, like, oh, I mm-hmm. can't play this, but this is easy. But I'll also be like, this is extremely difficult for a piano player to play.
Right.
This is not based on me. Like, please don't bring in the Beauty Is. It's very hard for most people.
Yeah.
So I usually can judge based on how well or not well I play, how well other people can accompany.
Yeah. Yeah. Totally.
I was looking at Light in the Piazza the other day and I was just like, I could try really hard to figure out how to count this, but I can't figure it out.
Yeah.
And then like when you listen to different tracks for it, it's like kind of hilarious.
It's all different. All different tempos.
You're like, wait a second. Who knows? Huh? Who knows the actual way?
Truly, truly.
Okay. So when did you know that coaching was something that you could basically, I mean, obviously you just said high school, you were low key coaching. Did you start actually coaching people in college or was that really like a post school thing for you?
Post school, because more backstory for those of you who don't know, I was singing at the head of the program's house in 2006. It was a Dream Girl song. It was very inappropriate. I was singing it operatically, belting it, and then I sang the last note off key because that's my brand. Everyone was laughing, and at the exact right moment, the Dream Girls movie was coming out 6 months later. So there's this freshman who's filming it. Yes, girl, yes! You know, and probably a flip phone. I don't even know. It was like shaky.
Super shaky,
And then he posted it on his account on YouTube, and then it went viral, in quotes, which was 100,000, not 9 billion.
Mm-hmm.
Like TikTok.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then it literally went viral in the musical theater community. So like my senior year of college, my showcase video went viral, but I didn't even have a channel yet. And then at the same time, the University of Michigan kids like Andrew Keenan Bulger were posting videos and we were like mutually acquainted through friends. And this is like Pasek and Paul's class, like Justin and Ben, that's how I met them too, through all these projects. But my showcase video sort of went viral. And then I got this opportunity to sing with Scott Allen, sang I'm a Star, which was also not on my channel. I think it was on Andrew Keenan Bulger's channel.
Oh, wow.
And then I was like, I guess I'll make a YouTube channel. Like it was like later. So yeah. It was like completely accidentally viral. Mm-hmm. And so I always say my career is on purpose and accidental.
Yeah.
So it was like really right place, right thing. And I did like capitalize on it and, you know, build something different. But it was like, I wanted to be famous growing up, mm-hmm. and I'd never thought that it would ever happen. I mean, because there's no internet in 1993. Right. So
totally.
But the coaching, because my following was like growing, I could have built in students that they were like, you could teach me to belt, which isn't normally the case.
Yeah. Mm.
So my coachings, I was like, sure, I'd love to teach you. I had like one student in New Jersey. It was like 40 an hour, you know, like, yeah. Sure, I'll start my business.
Business. Yeah.
But, you know, I always did want to teach. Like, I almost went to school for music ed. I decided musical theater because, you know, theater people, you can spot them across the room. Like, there are people.
Yeah.
Music ed people, like, are just, like, a little bit different. I couldn't, like, put my finger on it. But theater people was my vibe. But I did apply for music ed programs. Mm-hmm. So I guess it was, like, because I didn't learn how to teach. I didn't go to school for pedagogy. So it was a lot of, like, natural instincts, learning as I taught, learning more every year as I teach. It definitely started after. And then it was just, you know, started with small clientele. And it was like, then it would be like, hi, I'm from Amsterdam. I'm coming into town for 1 week. Teach me? Sure, you're free Tuesday. Like there was no schedule. I didn't have, like, my hours are this. You know?
Yeah, no, yeah.
And that's how it started. Yeah. Wow. And then like about probably when I met you 5 years ago or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Six is when my coaching. So I posted this coaching video for fun. This kid singing Words Fail. I wasn't even commenting. I was just like,
oh, this is so cool. Yeah.
He's so good.
Yeah.
No editing, I think.
Right.
And then they were like, post more. I was like, okay. And then like half my job is editing because I have so many gigabytes of old coaching. So then I had to have an application process after that because I was just for fun. Again, it was I always say that what I posted was fun, educational, or authentic. It was never like, and now I will post on Tuesday and get 9 million likes. Like,
right.
So I always talk about, this is a pivot, but my most viral video is the video with Renee Rapp where she's holding her leg up on TikTok.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
And it has like 6 million views and it's a repost. It's like, I guess I'll just post this.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
What? There's no calculation in that.
Right.
Right.
Meanwhile, like my most clever duets are like, why isn't anyone seeing them? Why aren't they viral?
Right. Exactly.
You're like, hello.
It's kind of a hit or miss. Yeah.
Yeah. There's like no rhyme or reason.
Yeah. That's why when people ask me like, do you have any strategy for building an online presence? And I'm like, I literally am not trying to be rude when I say I have no strategy.
Yeah.
Right.
And I just say like, you must have something of you on the internet that you like, because nowadays if you are hiring somebody for a job, you need to have an instant clip or else, sorry, we're moving on.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
How do you navigate like the posting on social media, all of that world with also your own like, and coaching with also your own theatrical career? How do you like balance those two worlds? Because if they feel, they can feel very separate, I feel like maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I would say like graduating, I was like auditioning primarily.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then I would have students, whereas people would have like a waitressing job. My students would be like my side hustle.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then like I do shows, I do tours. On tour, I started getting asked to do master classes. So I was like, honestly, it started becoming like, I was a swing on Les Mis.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I was like creatively unfulfilled, but making the most money of my life. So I was like, I'm never leaving this job. And everyone stayed the whole time and they all bought apartments and I wish I did.
But
who'd have thunk?
Totally.
But on the road, I used to be like almost more excited to do a master class and like, I guess I'll show up and watch Netflix now backstage. And I was like, I guess I'll go on for Crazy Whore.
Yeah, exactly.
Like I just totally, just was invigorated. Best line.
Truly.
I was invigorated making breakthroughs and then I'd be like, I'm at work now. And it was like, it started to feel like secondary.
Yeah.
So then, since then I kind of like say that I do a show a year and it has to be very specific.
Yeah.
And then during the pandemic, not to be backwards, but my teaching stuff took off like more than ever because I had already been doing it. And then all of a sudden it was like Zoom was the thing.
Yeah.
So like one of my best months financially was September 2020.
Yeah.
Because I did like belting for classical singers.
Right.
And it was like the first time I had over 300 apps and I had never had that many for anything. And everyone wanted to like I had 100 people apply to observe only, which was like a game changer because in the city before then, it would be like, all right, apply to perform. Maybe however many would apply, I would pick, I don't know, 15. And then maybe a voice teacher would observe.
Right.
Like a mom.
Right.
And then all of a sudden it was like, hi, I'm from Russia and I have a voice to do it. Like it was crazy. So now I try to open up observers in person on Zoom.
Yeah.
Right.
So a lot of that stuff isn't going away.
And right.
Sit in my pajamas.
Yeah.
On Zoom.
Right.
So that was crazy. But the balancing, I would say, like finding where you want to put your energy and stuff.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so if something came up, like I would viscerally get an appointment and be like, no thanks. I'd rather teach. Like I remember being like, ugh.
Wow.
And then I would be like when I got offered Ghost 6 years ago, maybe I got the email like, hi, would you like to play Molly and Ghost? And my first thing was like, oh, I have five friends that are better. Like, it's never like,
wow,
oh my God, I'm dying to do this. So I can never tell if it's like fear or don't want to. That's a big thing with me.
Yeah.
So when the witch came up, one of my best friends booked the show. Mm-hmm. Then she booked Sweeney Todd and Parade, her two Broadway debuts. She chose Parade.
Wow.
But she was like, hey, and she got offered it. She sent in a tape. I watched her tape. It was brilliant. And then it was like 6 months. She got cast 6 months ahead. So the whole cast knew.
Wow.
And then I had like 5 days to put together a tape. And I was like, the witch. I've never even thought of myself as this. All right. So then I just started like acting like nonsense on film. And I was like, wait, is this the best tape I've ever done? Because I'm just like not.
Yeah.
I'm actually like not being self-conscious Natalie acting. And then I was like, oh, okay. This. But then I had like, I think maybe you saw this, but I posted a video about anxiety. It sort of blew up. Because I was like, I can't do this. Like, I'm incapable.
Yeah.
No, I got past
it. I so appreciated that because I was like, I feel like there's a lot more people that feel like this than like we let on.
Yeah. You know? And it was, And it got better.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, like, I noticed this, especially with my own anxiety. Zoom, harder because I'm like, not to be rude, but if I'm like this, I could be texting a friend and they don't know. I'm not saying
totally.
I do that.
No, yeah.
But when I'm playing, let's say I'm having like some kind of minor panic attack and then a student comes over and I'm like, yeah, totally.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'll be like four bars into their song playing and then I'll be like complete because I'm outward and I'm so my mind doesn't stop.
Yeah.
So if I'm coaching and playing and sight reading, I feel less anxious by the end of the 30 minutes. And then I would catch myself being like, this is the world I meant. And then I was like, what's for dinner? Like I was
not in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then I would catch myself doing like guest entertainment shows on ships, which is like lucrative to a point, but I'm not a ship person.
Totally. Mm-hmm.
I would. And also I love doing my own shows that I put together that like the audience is like,
yeah,
there for you laughing. Yeah. What was really hard for me during those lucrative moments is that the audience, maybe I have one fan who's like on the ship. I didn't know you were here.
Yeah.
But then you have people in the front row sleeping because they're like, what's on tonight? And I'm like, I want to die.
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
So I'm literally like singing like whatever.
Killing it. Yeah.
And then I'm like, I don't want to be here, but I'm making money. You know?
Yeah.
It was just like noticing. And I had a distinct moment. I was teaching in Vienna, Austria. I was like, I'm so blessed to be doing this.
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't want to go to class right now. And then my dad, who's a pharmacist, was like, I was like, my dad counts pills for a living. Like I just had this like, my dad stands on his feet for 12 hours and is, hey, how's it going? Like, no, they're not, they don't do their passion. Like my dad loves golf. He loves poker. He loves football.
Right.
But he doesn't do that. And so I love poker. I want to be a poker player, but like we did do what we liked doing. It's very hard to remember like the separation from job to pleasure. I never sing for fun. And if I sing for fun with my friend who we film it, sometimes we have to film it because it's content. It's not just like, we're not like in a jam and have fun. It's like, get the camera out. Cause like everything has to be filmed.
Right.
It is such a hard, like that line between work and joy does, it becomes so like messy and blurry and being able to, and I think personally, at least for me, that's where my anxiety or performance anxiety or whatever, that's where that stems from. Cause I'm thinking all the time, like, oh, okay, I have to make sure like this is good. Like it's content. It's like, it could get me a job. It could not get me a job. And so being able to like just be able to enjoy. I remember going to see Waitress. After. Honestly, I don't remember. I couldn't tell you.
I saw it like 5 times.
I know. It was my first show after the pandemic.
Oh.
And I had seen it before, but it was like one of the first ones to open. And so I like jumped on getting an opportunity to be back in the theater. And I remember coming back in and just for the first time in a long time, sitting in a theater and being just overwhelmed with how much I loved I loved the theater.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Not, I wasn't thinking about like, oh, who could be in this audience that I should meet? Oh, right. Like how can I get my way to the orchestra so I could like, you know, should I stage door? Is that cringy or is that like fine?
No, do I entranced in what you're watching?
Yeah. And so I think that like the fact that you recognize that blurriness and have been able to navigate it, it seems like very well, is so it's inspiring to me. It makes me go, man, okay, I need to evaluate how I look at myself and my career and what I love to do. Yeah. Rach and I have both been in observed masterclasses or been in one of your masterclasses. Yeah. And one thing I love about watching you teach is you can tell how much you love to teach and watch other people have breakthroughs. And that is huge. Because most people, I mean, I've been in master classes where I've come in and I'm like, oh, this teacher is just in here because they want to look cool.
Yeah. And then they go, is that different? And you're like, I didn't do anything different.
Yeah.
And you just say, yes.
You're like, I'm really huge.
Do you feel the change there?
Yeah. And you're like,
no, I just sang it again.
Yeah. You've seen that,
right? I mean, look, I don't have breakthroughs. So real. Speaking of shameless plug, which I'll probably segue into.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, I have this documentary out that Greg made. And it's called thatbreakthrough.com.
Wow.
Well, it's called That Breakthrough, but you can get it at thatbreakthrough.com.
Yeah.
And it's a day in the life of a masterclass that I did. But a lot of what I say is that I just live for that.
Yes.
I'm just like invigorated by that moment.
Yeah. And I think
whether it's small or big.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, and it's so cool to me that that is the case, because I think having a teacher that is so passionate about seeing you have a breakthrough really pushes somebody to be to the point in which they feel uncomfortable, because lots of times in life or in art or whatever, the breakthrough doesn't happen until it feels like it won't.
Oh, yeah, yeah. If that and then makes all of a sudden it's sense. On the cusp.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And it's because we're worried about making content or being perfect or all of these different things, it is hard to get uncomfortable, and you have to be able to make the breakthrough.
Right.
So I remember in masterclasses with you or in coachings with you, where you would look at me and be like, you sound pretty. Stop it. Like, stop acting like you're like being, stop. Just or like sing the note.
Be like, that was flat. Like, no, stop self-correcting. Stop. I'll do that.
That's my job.
Yeah.
That's why I'm here. And having somebody, I think, I really value, one of the things I really value in you, there are multiple things, but one thing is you are for people and you're for other artists. And that is huge in an industry where that is rare. It seems to be rare. And so just to encourage you in that, like,
thanks.
The fact that you're for other people and other students and people who are coming up and people who are just figuring out the industry or people who have been here for a long time, it's really valuable.
Thanks.
It's really, really valuable.
One of my realization moments of like, I love having, cause I'm often confused.
Yeah.
Like all the time. Like, I don't know what I want. I know what I don't want, but I'm like very confused a lot.
Yeah.
One of my moments of seeing, as you know, I love a senior showcase.
Heyo.
Because that's like, I don't know. I'm just like a talent whore. I'm obsessed with
it.
And I remember seeing a showcase with this guy. I remember he saying How Glory Goes from Floyd Collins. And I was just like watching him. And I remember instead of being like, I want to be on stage, I was like, I want to be his agent. Like, I remember like specifically thinking that.
Yeah.
So like, I joke, but I've been an agent for like 15 years unpaid.
Yeah, yeah. Totally.
And like a manager. And like, I recently like had a coaching with somebody who was, she blew my mind and I was feeling guilty that she paid this money and I am not like, good job, next. I'm like, I need to find something.
Right.
And I like had her sing her whole book and I was like, I don't have any notes. Like, I had like one note and I was like, but let me think of what I can do. And then I like got her a manager and got her recording with two composers.
Right.
And then she was like, oh, it changed my life. And I was like, oh my God, that's so great. Cause I felt like I was not helping her at all.
Yeah.
One day I'll get that finder's fee or something.
Exactly.
But I love connecting people. That's like my literal favorite part of this business.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I wish it could be like lucrative as professional connector,
totally.
But recently I had one of my favorite days of my entire career was I did a student showcase in, I thought about asking you too, but I hadn't worked with you in like years. So yeah, it was like more recent. I would love it.
Yeah.
And I had 38 performers. It was two concerts, two set lists, at City Winery. And, I put together some strangers that I was like, I think they would vibe. And then I like made duets out of solos. Like one of them was One Perfect Moment from Bring It On.
Cool.
These two 17-year-olds. It was like so good. They blended so well. I did Breathe From In The Heights as a duet and they both sang half in Spanish. And,
so cool.
And then I did Move In The Line duet. Yes. And it was just like when they met, they vibed and I was like, I'm obsessed with this. And it was like everyone became best friends. Right. And then it was very fun. I want to do more of them.
Yeah.
So fun.
That's so fun.
Because then you're like getting
like
to
producer vibe.
Yeah, yeah. You're like putting the whole thing.
Yeah.
Like you're
and honestly,
to be
I'm bossy AF. So I was like, if it's not done the way that I want, like, I'm sorry. Like,
yeah,
I'm
yeah.
So then I could like, you know, micromanage like
yeah.
I like.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
then,
yeah. 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 Totally.
Hire who I want to hire.
I know.
And do it my way.
I know.
Right.
That's when that's one reason like what I like directing is
yes.
because I can be like, no, I don't like that.
No,
no, yeah. Let's try something else. Let's yeah. do something different. Yeah. I totally get that.
I'm okay being told what to do, but lately no names or no experiences dropped.
Totally. Totally.
I don't do well with inefficiency. So if I know it could be done better, I don't do well. I'm okay. I love collaborating.
Yeah.
But you have to find the people that like you collaborate with well.
100%.
And when I'm like, I don't know why it's being done like this, I start imploding.
Yeah. Yeah. Totally. 100%. I get that.
Accurate. I have a quick question before we move on to the next one.
Yeah.
Cause I'm curious, have you felt like as your like coaching business has kind of like exploded over the last 5 years, you said?
Yeah.
Have you, and even before that, have you felt like you've had to learn a lot of like business skills as you've like grown in this? And even with, I mean, I know you say like, what is it? Like, it's like an accident on purpose.
Yeah.
Is that
like
what you say?
Accidental and on purpose.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
With social media, like, has that been, I don't know, what has that process been like for you? Just business mind
and
slash
social media mind.
Yeah. And creative still.
And creative. So like, for example, I was brought out to Alaska random 5 years ago. It came up on
so
my
cool,
5
awesome.
Years ago feed
yeah.
for like a 3-day teaching thing. And then usually what's cool is that I bond with like the main person there. So like did I stay at a hotel? Yeah, I didn't stay at her place. I stayed at a hotel, but we like, she took me to all the touristy things so that
cool.
we kept in touch. She connected me with this Facebook group of voice teachers and her business coach. So I met like a business coach who like taught me about, you know, one of the most game changing things is canned responses on Gmail. I don't know if you use this, but like, hi, you can like write a response and then be like, all the time. It's like a copy paste kind of a thing.
Yeah, cool. Yeah.
But like, I'm just going to give you an example. So one of them is like, you know, for the, my assistant or whoever's writing the email,
right.
Application comes through and then you just write canned response, new student. And then it's just there. You don't have to like,
oh, cool.
One of them, like I label as like, Natalie is not a doctor. So it's like, hi to Natalie and her team.
Yeah.
I recently had bronchitis and I hemorrhaged. What do I do? Natalie is not a medical doctor. Please seek or something. It's like one of them. It's just like, I can't advise you.
Yeah.
Or
yeah.
like, let's say there's a child whose mom is like, I want to take lessons. Natalie does not take on, you know, clients under 15. Here are some referrals, just anything that's like a very commonly.
Right.
Yeah.
Some of them I was like, I don't think I'm ever going to get this again. So, but that was helpful.
Yeah.
Pricing. Scheduling. I didn't know you could make your own hours. I was like, don't you just work 24/7?
Yeah.
That's like
right,
totally
right, exactly.
what I do, right?
Yeah.
I love that Natalie is not a doctor.
It's called Natalie's not a medical doctor. I think it's labeled as.
I mean,
I could find these. Natalie's not a medical doctor. I mean, there's some funny ones.
You seem like, I mean, you're just
you
such
a
knowledgeable person about the voice, just like period. So I think it's like, I don't know. Like,
they really, no. I mean, you'd be shocked. Like, you should see some of the DMs. The social media thing, like, I have an amazing network of young friends. I have 17-year-old friends and 57-year-old friends. So,
right.
like, my, like, you know, people that are Gen Zers are like, you should use CapCut and this app that makes subtitle or auto captions.
Yeah.
And I'm like, huh? And then like, it must be vertical. And I'm like, what do you
You're
mean?
Like, what? Yeah.
So I really, the funny thing is like my TikTok following is the highest number. And when people are like, oh my God, I know you, I recognize you from TikTok. I'm like, I'm on YouTube. Like,
I'm not
a TikToker. I don't even know how to use it. Right. You know, like I saw your videos. Like I love your videos on Instagram and TikTok would make sense. But like I found you or I know you,
I know you from TikTok. It's so, that's crazy.
Because that was like pandemic. Like,
oh my God. Right.
I think I joined 2020.
Right.
So it's funny.
That's nuts. All right, guys, we gotta move on. Why do you think the arts are important?
Oh my God.
Just a light question.
I know, seriously. I guess I never realized, because I played sports growing up too, but to have like an outlet for creativity and weirdness, I feel like with me, I was called weird a lot. And I would be like, shut up, I'm not weird.
Yeah.
I get so mad.
So mad.
So defensive.
Yeah.
And I was bullied a lot growing up. I played a lot of instruments in like, oh God, middle school. Sixth grade was like the worst, seventh grade.
Yeah.
And they used to call me instrument girl. Wow. And it was really traumatizing. Like, I mean, and I looked really gross. I will show you a picture, but it truly gets better. I still have like confidence issues, but like before and after it gets better. It was a horrible, awkward time. Yeah. Like when I was 12 and 13, like I was not cute and I was so self-conscious and I used to get bullied at like Mean Girl summer camp where there were sports and I, you know, did the shows. But then I really found my people when I went to Frenchwood sleepaway camp and I just really found my people. And I'm social when I'm comfortable and when I'm, and I always say like, if I'm like on the, like Hell's Kitchen, comfortable, Midtown, I can socialize or like at a gathering mostly, but then Murray Hill, like, it's like businessmen in suits and like real people. And I'm like, what do I connect with you on? And like, I just like connect with artsy people. And I didn't realize that growing up. And I just feel like, you can like be yourself and like explore your, I would say creative side, but like your weird side.
Yeah.
I don't, that's not profound. I'm not a very profound talker.
But that's so important.
Yeah.
Why do you think the arts are important?
Well, I mean, I think to your point, I think lots of people, especially when they're coming up, when they're growing up in middle school, high school, whatever it may be, I've always said that the theater especially, or just kind of the arts in general, give a home for people who don't feel like they have one. And that has been like, that has been, to your point, a huge thing, is it gives you the opportunity to A, be completely yourself, because all of us are weird. Like that's the thing, all of us, like you get into a room of theater people or artists in general, and we're all like a little bit off. My dad and I joke always, because he's like, some of the best artists always are just like a tad, he says a couple fries short of a happy meal, which is the like phrase of like just a tad off. It's like, you know, we're all just a little weird. But that's why we're able to open ourselves up and be vulnerable and be able to empathize and have compassion with other people, is because, you know, we've gone through things, or we feel weird, or we have a hard time connecting with people, or whatever it may be. And so we're able to self-reflect a lot better, I think. Mm-hmm. And so that allows us to be able to produce art that impacts other people and gets them to look introspectively. Those guys in suits that are in Murray Hill, like they're going to be impacted because they watch a show on, they watch Ted Lasso, and then all of a sudden they're sitting in their bedroom being like, man, do I need to go to therapy? Like, or they go see a show on Broadway with their girlfriend that they're trying to impress. And then they end up sitting there going, man, maybe I do need to think about some things in my life.
Right.
And so I think like, that to your point and the way that you experience art is like allowing yourself to be weird. I think opening yourself up to that allows for other people to open themselves up as well.
Right.
And being weird makes life way more fun.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
I mean,
yeah,
that's not profound, but it is true.
Yeah.
You know? Okay. Question number three.
Yeah.
Is what keeps you grounded as a human?
I think like my community, honestly, like my my support system. Cause I always say like, you know, I remember like being in college as like, let's say a junior, and I had one friend in the city who graduated Penn State.
Yeah.
And I like crashed on her couch.
Yeah.
And then that was the only person I knew in the city. And then like you do one job and then you have like one friend and then you, every job you have increases your network. And I've had best friends for since college and like meeting friends at a game night, meeting them on the street, you know, at anything. And my mom's always like, you change friends a lot. And I'm like, no. I build, I'm not dropping friends. I'm just like, oh, I love when you meet this person. And did you know this person? Yeah. And then you just like build your network. And so that's really cool. Like, especially like when you're on, when you're in different shows, there are certain people that are like lifers and just, okay, that was a nice show I did with you. But some of them are like, you know, besties for life.
Yeah.
And just, you know, feeling really supported. And I think a lot of people in this business feel competitive and not supported. And I feel a lot of confusion, but I feel very certain of support, which I've been very grateful for.
Yeah. 100%. It is. It's that whole, you know, dynamic of, I want to work with you, but I'm also competitive against you. Mm-hmm. It's the whole, I was in a, audition room in person for the first time in a long time. I went in for the Little Women National Tour.
You did? And,
Everyone's
telling, okay.
But they like, exactly.
Did you get a call back?
No, I got an invited.
You got an invited round. In person.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it literally, for the first time in a long time, I walked in and I was like, oh my gosh, everybody's sizing each other up again.
Oh my
this God. Is weird. Like, I wanted to be like, guys, we're all friends. Like, this is, all of us are supporting each other. Somebody's going to get a job. You know what I mean?
I know.
But instead it does, it quickly turns into this like hyper competitive, like you walk into a room and everybody's looking at you some type of way.
But recently it was cool. Cause I had a final callback. I'll tell you what it was after.
Come on.
But like, I'm friends with the two other girls that I'm up against. So we're texting each other and like in the room, a lot of people were like, oh, what? And but the very beginning it was like, oh my God. Like, I know people in this room, but like it could go to anyone, and also like 8,000 different types of people. It's like, you know, but it does feel nice. It's so weird. Like, really, we're in the waiting room, I'm like, this is so gross. But then like casting directors that come in and like help teach my students, like as guests, they're like, you know, you need to bring like what you bring. And they try to dispel it, like, just share your new material. It's not about, I must get this job. I'm like, oh, that makes it so easy, but it's so weird.
Yeah, it is.
You know, it's different than okay, come on in. Let's get an interview for your job. It's like, interview?
I heard once to like change the perspective from booking the job to booking the room.
Oh,
and that really helped like
get them on your side and
kind of just like, you just want to like make a good impression, because like it could be this job, but it could be different one, you know? So like, I think especially when you're, you know, around people that you know outside of the audition room, or a bunch of people that you don't know, it's just kind of helpful to be like, okay, it could be this, it could be another one. Like,
that's what it
is. Who knows?
You never know.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Our next question is, what person, place, or experience has shaped you the most creatively?
Okay. I mean, I guess I would say, it's cheesy, but I would say Mariah Carey and Whitney Houston.
I love that.
Yeah.
As an 8-year-old, and SWV Week. If you don't know that song, you need to know it.
Okay.
I learned, like, I remember like in 1993 being like, I get so weak in the knees, I can hardly speak, you know, bad singing. Yeah. But I remember like trying to do the riffs and my mom's like, can you please stop singing? It was that song, Hero, early shaping. Later on. Okay. Hold on. Best experience. Okay. So then I would say not shaped me, but one of the best rooms I've been in was The Greatest Showman, the viral video.
Yeah.
I've watched that so many times.
It actually was just so magical. Like, you're the worst singer in the room. Like, you're surrounded by like such greatness, and you just knew. Like, I remember leaving that and being like, this is going to be the hugest thing ever. And it was like, it surpassed it.
Yeah.
So that was definitely like a very energetic, positive room.
Yeah.
Not shaped, but just like memorable.
Totally.
When I, you know how I said the student concert recently is like a highlight, but I also did a very similar job, which was one of my top professional things, was when I like stage managed, produced, music directed, organized.
Oh my gosh.
Everything. My mentor's retirement party. Oh, wow. My voice is retirement party and like lighting directed. Don't know anything about that. But I was again like,
yeah.
And it was efficient and it was entertaining and it was really fulfilling and I got paid $0.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's always like the things. Yeah.
With the Greatest Showman room, you said, you know, feeling like you're the, you know, least talented vocalist in the room. I know Rach often talks about how like she likes to be feeling like that feeling of like, oh, I'm the least talented in the room or I'm the least experienced or whatever, because that makes you like rise better, to the occasion. Yeah. Yeah. Is that right?
Yeah, and you like learn the most because you're not just learning from like
your own
the
feedback.
Teacher, but you're also learning from the people, like your peers.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
Did you feel that way in that room?
Yeah, I mean, just like everyone singing together and like this music's just so epic.
Yeah.
So good.
Yeah, it just was like, and there were so many cats, like we were the same ensemble, but we kept seeing like, I don't know, Sutton Foster did an early reading. Like just everyone was
wow.
Like
coming through this project. Just
I was going to say, oh, it's like I play tennis. I haven't played in a long time, but I don't like to play with people that are worse than me. I always like to play up because you play better.
Oh yeah.
Right.
It's like the challenge of, I think it, sometimes you surprise yourself.
Yeah.
Like when you're in a room like that or in a, have a match like that.
Right.
You're like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
And then, not that it shaped me, but the course that I made 2 years ago, which was basically like my life's work into one product.
Yeah.
So it was a big accomplishment.
Mm. How long did that take you to make?
My whole life. And right. I'm going to say like probably 8 months to like, put it on paper, like construct it. And then the filming was one day, but the actual doing it. And then the editing was, about 7 months.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
That's insane.
And then I was like, that's the last one.
You're like, that was it. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much.
Yeah. Okay. Last question. What book, play, or film do you think every person should read or watch?
Well, this is a very random answer because I'm not a reader, but one of the best books I've ever read that had me sobbing in the bed about 16 years ago was The Time Traveler's Wife.
Oh yeah.
That's just my first answer in terms of book.
That's what a beautiful story.
Movie, oh my gosh.
Book or?
Or song.
I mean,
honestly.
I have so many
song.
Favorite movies. It's like some of them are like, you must see How to Lose a Guy in 10 Days. Like,
yeah.
No, or it's like, you must see Speed from 1994.
Yeah.
Like,
yes.
I mean, I don't know. I'm just going to like shout out some like Forrest Gump. Like,
Must sees.
Or even like shows, like any shows that you're like, people got to see this.
I mean,
or
listen honestly, to I love Bright Star so much.
Gosh.
It's like top three favorite shows.
Yes.
Such a sleeper and like should not have closed.
Correct.
I love Legally Blonde.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I love Next to Normal. I love Dear Evan Hansen.
You said Bright Star was in your top three favorite shows. What are your other two?
I think Legally Blonde,
Legally
Next
Blonde
to Normal,
and Next to Normal.
Yeah.
Bright Star, Dear Evan Hansen, Parade.
Huh.
Definitely.
Oof. Yeah.
You must. What are your you must? Maybe I'll think of stuff as you.
As far as movies.
Either.
Movies for me are Dead Poets Society.
Never saw. On my list.
Just cuddle with a thing of popcorn and just in a box of tissues. Just be ready. But as an artist, it will like, at least for me, it just like grabs my heart and just like, and you as a teacher as well, I think it'll speak directly to who you are as a human. Dead Poets Society, Funny Girl, Barbara Streisand.
I saw it this year for the first time, the movie.
The movie?
First time.
Did it undo
me too.
You?
First time.
Yeah.
Really?
It was great.
Yeah. It makes me cry every single time I watch it. And then Little Women, the Greta Gerwig version.
Okay.
I think like as a film, it is like inspiring to me as an artist, but also the way that she like drops these one-liners of just like gold of like, I want to be great or nothing, you know, or like the whole woman monologue that Joe has, or like there are all these small little nuggets that you can kind of latch onto and be like, wow, yeah, that I need to think about that.
Right.
And so I think that, and it also will make you like laugh happily and like sob at the same mm-hmm. time. Yeah, those would be my three like films. I think I could go on and on about theater, but
I just remembered, have you seen Mr. Holland's Opus or no?
Oh no, is it no. great?
It's like one of the best ever. A lot of my best friends have never seen it either.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's about a music teacher. It's yeah. unbelievable. I cry every time. But I think that's an important film. I just thought of that.
Yeah.
What about plays or books?
Yeah, Rach.
Or movies.
Well, Come From Away is like would probably be the show that I say. I just think it's everything that musical theater
should be.
Yeah. I just read Howard's End by E.M. Forster, which is like, okay, you know, I know the old movie, but yeah. British. And I watched the movie, and then there's a miniseries too. The miniseries is beautiful. It's kind of like, have you seen the two Pride and Prejudice? Like mm-hmm. there's like the old Keira BBC Knightley. One, and then there's the Keira Knightley one. And it's kind of like people are very partial to like the Colin Firth BBC one, but I think the Keira Knightley one is just like beautiful. Mm-hmm. Anyway, all this to say, the Howard's End, the book is just like gorgeous.
Natalie, do you have any other thoughts for the people listening? Anything, any place you want people to get connected? You said your documentary, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So
the breakthrough.
Thatbreakthrough.com.
That breakthrough. Come on.
Okay. We'll link it down.
Well, link it.
Yeah.
And then my Instagram and TikTok is the Natalie Weiss.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. The Natalie Weiss.
Natalie Weiss wouldn't give me her handle.
Wait, what?
I tried to buy it from her.
Really?
Yes.
And she said no?
She said, I have an eBay store. I'm sorry. I was like, excuse me. I will pay you for this handle. She's like, I'm so sorry.
And you were like,
check out Natalie Weiss on Instagram. She won't give it to me. I think she has like 300 followers.
That's hilarious.
Wow.
Yeah,
wow.
So it's always like my Venmo and everything. Dina, you know?
Yeah.
Don't follow me on Venmo.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't want to be like, Dina Natalie Weiss, but like, yeah.
No, I love it. I love it. That's awesome.
You do what you got to do.
Yeah, exactly.
Rachel Gifford is a pretty common name too. So,
what's your name on?
Instagram, Rachy Gif.
Oh, Rachy Gif.
Very,
super cute.
Natty Y. No.
Natty Nat Y. Yeah.
Okay, so thatbreakthrough.com. Yep. And then the Natalie Weiss. The Natalie Weiss.
Yeah.
Thanks for being here. We really appreciate you. This has been super fun. And
such a blast.
Yeah.
We really value you.
Big fans.
Yeah, aww, big fans.
Truly.
Big fans. And we're glad that we are collaborators. And yeah, we really appreciate you a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
All right, guys.
You guys, go out there.
Bye.
Make art. Natalie says bye. make art. Encourage each other. Champion each other. Hey, go take class. Go take class. Take one of Natalie's workshops.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we hope that you feel inspired today and you go make some art. We'll see you guys next time.
Thanks for listening to the For the Makers podcast. To find out more about Seated Productions, you can visit our website at www.seatedproductions.com and follow us on Instagram at seated.productions. And if you love what we do and want to support us, you can make a tax-deductible donation by visiting our website or by following the link in our podcast description. Until next time, listen well and tell stories.